So welcome back to Wakefield, Harvey and Joyce.
Song. It was written in the middle 1800s by a horseback preacher from mostly from Ohio and southern Michigan. I think he was born in Pennsylvania, but it's amazing to us how that song came to be and how it came to be known by so many people with sort of grassroots gospel.
Kind of inspires me to become a horseback preacher. That sounds fun.
quite the wind chill last night. Let's sing about it.
I don't know if that's a good idea.
Well, not the cold north wind.
I liked it when our boy got home from school and he ripped off his sweatshirt and he went out in his t-shirt to see how it was. He's like, this isn't bad. But then he went out later, I guess, when we were in bed and it was recorded. It was 40 below zero with the wind chill.
We live in southern Maine.
So yeah, it's impressive.
Anyway, here's one of my... We used to sing this together when we was just a courting.
Thank you.
one I call To the Western Wind. Well, one of the things we've been doing during the confusing last few years of our lives is some online YouTube live stream things. And one of the things you learn when you do that is you need a lot of songs. So you did them last week and you did those the week before, so we've been dusting off all kinds of songs, and we've also been playing a bit with our the Naughty Pine Boys, our mythical country western band.
Partly mythical.
Yeah, we're becoming less mythical, which is we've gotten increasingly fond of singing old, I guess what they call classic country songs.
I don't think they call it that. I think that's somebody the does. Stuff that's on the radio.
Yeah.
No, that's new country. That was a while
it's
ago.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Pre-bro country.
Old time country, maybe.
Yeah, we don't know.
Yeah. It's not hot new country.
So we usually have a drummer and a pedal steel player when we sing this, but we're going to hear it before you hear a classic duet from, boy, George, I think George and Tammy sang this, didn't they? Yeah. Porter and Dolly did, might have been the first hit with it.
So our alter egos are Hank and Dixie.
All right.
Hank and Dixie Baxter. And we just got a gig. Where the band was born, right down the street, a different ownership, but same funky little restaurant in a basement, kind of like a Unitarian church coffee house, but different. And anyway, so we love those guys, and we're loving these songs. Here's one of our favorites.
This one sort of predates Photoshop. Nowadays, you don't have to carry around pictures with people you don't want in the picture.
Bye.
Dixie. Oh, Joyce lives here. Dixie hasn't sung this yet, has she? No.
Dixie, maybe Dixie will sing it right now.
Yeah.
And see what happens.
Happened since I've seen you is every 45 years I seem to pick up another autograph. See if I can play this one. Here, you tell him a funny story there while I play. And I never could make any sense out of a piano or a harp, but I'm going to sort of fantasize here. I'm looking more and more as I'm theoretically aging gracefully here. I'm looking more and more like one of those old guys in the pictures of harps that I used to see, the woodcuts from the Middle Ages. People. One of the things I learned while researching my big epic Troubadour Chronicles book was that the guitar didn't make it to Europe, where our ancestors came from. Guitar came late, and they came from North Africa and the Middle East. It was the idea of a fingerboard with strings that you push down was kind of a newfangled idea. And then most of the stringed instruments in Europe were harps. So we'll do it. And Phil didn't make it. There were horsehair things. I think they came from the Middle East too, the horse culture. So this, theoretically, you couldn't have had the auto harps much later, but the sound we'll make will be reminiscent of something maybe that 1600s when the violin showed up or something.
Well, our kids think you're from the 1700s.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, we're not really far off. So this one was voted by the people of Ireland, I read, as their favorite of their traditional airs. And we won't sing the words that were written in the 1940s to it. Especially not in the state where Billy Walsh comes from. He does our favorite version of the song that you might recognize. So we'll withdraw into our viola. Well, viola predated the viola, so we'll pretend it's the 1500s. Thank you. another favorite of ours by one of my guitar heroes. The story of Billy Gray, the Outlaw.
Granger, come.
to sing that to our kids. Our kids are 14 and 17, and hopefully they're just being real well behaved back at home. Yeah, they're good boys. Yeah. It's a really special year for us. I really feel it, you know. The family's kind of gelling. It's good. They're becoming young men, and we're hanging on for dear life. We're doing all right. We're very grateful to Tom Papa, the comedian, who says, "You're doing great." Yeah. We say that to each other a lot. Well, we got a church in town, First Parish Church, and we can walk to church, which we sometimes do. And one of the services that we were going to play at was supposed to be outside and a few summers ago, and it was one of those really beautiful summers where it didn't rain and much. I mean, I guess I'm supposed to worry about drought. Sorry, I just love a dry summer. I shouldn't say that. Is that me? Anyway, we were going to play by the York River and kind of feel River of Jordan, kind of Sea of Galilee energy right there.
Oh, right. We worked up the song about the River Jordan.
This is one of the songs we worked up, the Sea of Galilee one.
And we ended up doing it on a rainy day indoors.
The minister from Nebraska was very savvy, and she put a blue tarp down where we were playing to make us feel like
we sang to a blue tarp there. Although when we
very resourceful.
When we had our kids, remember the midwife told us that she'd birthed an awful lot of kids in Maine on blue tarps. Somebody put together a database of where they loaded in all the old hymnals that they could find, just to keep track of what was in them. You know, there was a lot of music spread around that way, and I learned this from I bought the whole 13 CD box set of the Carter Family when it came out, because I've always wanted to hear more of what they did way back when. And 350 or 60 tracks there, and I was just looking for stuff to play on my auto harp, and I hadn't heard this song much. If I had heard it, it didn't sink in, and I latched onto the melody and been playing it on the auto harp for years. Lately, we've become enamored with the beautiful words from probably the 1700s. Yeah. But apparently, it said in this database that it might have been the number one, appeared in more hymnals than any other of the hymns in the, at least in the young America there, in the days of that. We're going to sing this song here, and we'll think we'll try to channel A. Pete Carter. We'll try to channel all kinds of stuff here. And we'll think about that blue tarp there. Thank you. is walking on the sea. And I have many brothers, but we don't sing duets with any of them. So I think Massachusetts was one of the first states to allow mixed gender brother duets.
Yeah, it's one of the first places we felt comfortable.
Yeah. The brother duet is one of the lost components of bluegrass music. It's not lost, but it's just not talked about. It's just, I don't know if it was ever cool. Cool wasn't really a big thing in the 1930s. Cool has grown a lot. And I don't think there's a lot of, certainly based on our research on teenage brothers, there's not a lot of them sitting around with their acoustic guitar and mandolin singing in high voices about Mama and Jesus. But what a beautiful bunch of music. And we're going to channel our favorite of those brother duets. The brother duet snobs generally award the goat category to Bill and Earl Bolick. Maybe we should explain. No, I guess you don't have to explain that phrase. Our kids say it all the time. Not that there ever was a contest to see who was the greatest brother duet of all time. But we want to sing this one. I think this is the first song that we ever really sunk our brother duet teeth into.
Yeah, you were singing it with another woman. What's that? That broke my heart. Yeah. I weaseled my way in, though, I guess.
I conveniently blotted that. I did. needed those sectors from my heart.
Singing that song about wanting to marry you. Where is that L? Okay, I won't get confused here. Let's just sing the song.
It's just, they're just words to an old song.
Thank you.
too.
Yeah. What a great town. I was glad to kind of miss the turn and just kind of go down through the center there. And you're really lucky. I don't know who lives here. Does anyone here live here? Yeah, a few. No, so not so many. You kind of came in. We live in a very sleepy town, York, Maine. There's not a lot of stores, really, in the town center. So I kind of envy that.
Yeah, it hides its capitalism better than we worked this one up relatively recently, considering that most people my age with guitars learned this 50 years ago, but I knew. Here, and I think you'll forgive us for singing about this subject. Too many good musicians have been passing on, and I could spend the rest of my life just paying tribute to all the wonderful musicians that I, even just the ones I knew personally that were awesome, not to mention, well, I guess that's what happens when you don't look in the mirror. But anyway, this one was written by... pillar of the New England folk music scene. He just lived a few miles from us there.
If he was ever there.
Yeah, he traveled a lot.
He traveled a lot.
So it's all the, just to think fondly of Bill Staines.
Different songs. Yeah.